Welcome to Blues Weekly, brought to you by Scott Credit Union. I'm Brooke Grimsley. Look, I wish there was a week where we didn't have to talk about the Blues playing with a depleted roster, but each week the story remains the same with a new hurdle for the Blues to overcome. And this week was no different. Despite playing shorthanded, though, they were able to pick up three straight wins heading into tonight's game against the Anaheim Ducks. Let's take a look at what happened. Second period, Ducks already up 1-0, but Walker here fakes, then passes to Oscar Sundquist. He taps in his first goal of the season to tie the game up 1-1. Third period, we are still tied up here, but the Aussie Nathan Walker, doing it all here on his own, snipes one top shelf to give the Blues a 2-1 lead. But later on in the third, Gillies with a save, but the puck can't be stopped. Troy Terry with the rebound and scores, ties the game up again 2-2 this time, so we have to go to overtime. In OT now, watch this, Scott Perunovich here with a turnover and follows it up with a bad decision here. He hooks Terry, and that will give him a penalty shot, so it comes down to Gillies and Terry here, and Terry beats him. Final score in this one, 3-2, Ducks win it in overtime, snapping the Blues' 7-game win streak at home, but they still get a hard-fought point. Ryan O'Reilly talked about how much the call-ups have helped them.
It's not just getting the big goals, too. It's just all the little details, the energy that they're providing, the physicality. Coming up there and just paying attention for, you know, to every detail. It's impressive to see, and it's been a huge reason why we've been able to squeak out points and win hockey games. So it's something that it's really good to see, and you know, I'm sure they'll continue on.
For more insight on the Blues, we bring in now voice of the Blues, Chris Kerber. Kerbs, thank you so much for joining us from Enterprise Center right before puck drop against the Ducks. I feel like each week that we catch up, it seems like the storyline is the Blues battling through some adversity. This week was no different. They had to play shorthanded, even at one point, having 9 players out to either COVID-19 protocol or injury, including their number one and number two goalies. But it didn't matter, picking up 3 straight wins and 7 straight at home heading into this one tonight. Kerbs, have you seen anything like this past week in your career?
Well, I've seen teams that have dealt with a lot of injuries. I've seen teams where you've got injuries to your top players and several of them. And even just last season alone was a difficult one for the Blues when you consider the injuries to Tarasenko and Thomas and Sundquist and Colton Parayko dealing with injuries last year. But you put the injuries with the COVID list and having 3 guys on the COVID list this season, and it has been extremely difficult. And, of course, in that last game that the St. Louis Blues played, they also lost Jordan Kyrou. So when they went into tonight's game against the Anaheim Ducks, once again, the St. Louis Blues were playing with just 11 forwards. They had to play shorthanded again. There's just not cap room to bring the guys up because you don't get the cap space when somebody is on the COVID list, even if they are vaccinated, and every one of the Blues players was. So, yeah, it's been a bit of a challenge, but you got to love the way that this team has rallied around. Charlie Lindgren, 3 games in a row, 2 of them starts. He ends up going 3-0 for the Blues. They lock things down, and sure, they got a little schedule help the last couple of games, maybe playing teams a little bit further down in the standings, but you still got to win them, and that's exactly what they did.
Well, as you just mentioned there with Charlie Lindgren, we have to go back to how he even got up here. As we mentioned, Husso and Benner both out. Husso exiting later in that Panthers game, so the Blues relying on their 4th-string goalie, and that was Charlie Lindgren. And since then, he's been in between the pipes for the Blues through 3 games, stopping 54 out of 57 shots, including almost shutting out his former team last night.
You know, you have to credit the hockey operations department of this team, the scouting staffs, and also goaltending coach David Alexander. When they looked at, they knew that they were going to have to need some kind of veteran depth for the minor leagues that you can call up just in case something were to happen. And even though Joel Hofer played really well, once again, cap situations and bonuses play into call-ups right now. So they called up Charlie Lindgren, who had played 5 seasons in the Montreal Canadiens organization, Brooke, and look what he did. He came in totally cold 3 games ago, made 3 huge stops, and then eventually gets the win as Buchnevich scored in overtime. He follows that up with his first start as a Blue, gets the win, and then, as you mentioned, against the Montreal Canadiens, wound up doing a superb job, only allowing the 1 goal. He delivered exactly what the St. Louis Blues needed in that situation and what they would expect from that, and you got to really love it. He joined us at one point at the end of one of the games. He talked about great just being back in the National Hockey League and how easy it was to play and fun it was to play behind this defensive group. So, man, that is some depth. When all the players getting called up from your American Hockey League affiliate are impacting your hockey team and earning wins, you're doing something right.
Well, another one of my favorite stories from this past week, Curbs, is Nathan Walker recalled under emergency conditions and literally made the most of his opportunity, becoming the first Australian to generate a hat trick. Afterwards, he talks so much about the sacrifices that he and his family made to get to this point. It's just really hard not to love that story. Curbs, what did you think about it?
Well, you know, after he scored that hat trick, Brooke, you talked to several players. Saw Robert Thomas, and he said, couldn't have happened to a nicer guy. You know, when you heard from Dakota Joshua after that game, or you heard from Charlie Lindgren after that game, said you couldn't ask for it happening to a nicer guy. And we said, what is it about him? He said, and they told us he's such a leader down there and such a positive attitude. You know, for him to come over and be part of the Blues taxi squad last season and deal with it, his family and a young baby could not come over from Australia to join him. You know, so basically 6 of the first 9 months of his baby's life, he's over here working on a hockey career, and mom and his child were back in Australia in COVID travel restrictions. They couldn't come. So, you know, it was no doubt a tough year. He's infectious with his attitude. He's positive. And listen, he plays the game the right way. He'll go in, he'll stir it up. He's got the little guy with gumption to take the title away from Darren Pang for a little while he's here. He's just got this attitude about him that guys want to be around. It's a really positive thing that the Blues have when they can go down to the minors, call him up, and know that he fits into your room perfectly.
Well, the Blues having to navigate through some cap issues, as we mentioned, balancing, calling up players. But now we're getting to the point where some guys are starting to come back, returning from injury or COVID-19 protocols, such as David Perron, Tyler Bozak, and Jordan Binnington, and much more. Curbs, how will the Blues navigate this moving forward? Because it seems like it's a good problem to have right now that you have so many talented guys coming up from the Thunderbirds, but also some of your more veteran guys returning as well.
Yeah, the good news is, Brooke, is you've weathered the storm to this point, and you still have to hold out a little bit longer here. But you do have Tyler Bozak that is now off the COVID list. But keep in mind, when these guys go on the COVID list, they're not able to skate. They're not able to practice. So coming off of the COVID list does not necessarily mean that you're ready to return to action. Expect Jordan Binnington there to be able to come off of the COVID list on Monday. Now, again, that doesn't mean that you're just going to go straight from that so you're playing that Tuesday night down in Dallas. You don't want to risk the chance of a goaltender. We saw what happened with Billy Husso. You know, you're going to have to get these guys back into some game shape. The good news is David Perron appears to be close. You've got Bozak coming off the COVID list. You've got Binnington and Falk coming off the COVID list. Now it's just a matter of getting them back into game shape. We already know that it's still going to be another week or so before you could get a James Neal or a Clem Costin, because the long-term IR is very clear. It's 10 games and 24 days that you will be out. So you know that situation. Now, how do they handle it? Boy, there's a great question there. The one thing that has happened with all these call-ups is the St. Louis Blues players have known what their role is. Well, you get some guys back that are expecting to play top 6 minutes from a forward standpoint, top 4 minutes from a defensive standpoint, and roles have to shift down. And Doug Armstrong told us earlier in the week, the only thing that could derail a really deep team is ego. And the one thing we've seen during this most recent run of success is guys really accepting their roles. That's because it's a lot easier for someone to come up from the minors to do that. So as guys start to come back, we'll see how that ice time gets handled by not only the coaching staff, but the players themselves.
We'll have more from Curbs coming up after the break, but first, let's get to know Blues defenseman Colton Parayko.
Brouwer goes to the front. Now it comes on to Laterra for Parayko. Thought about shooting. Now he does. He scores! First NHL goal for Parayko!
Oh, man. He's a huge, massive part of this team on and off the ice. Leadership, like I said, a guy who carries himself offensive, defensive. He's really can do it all, and, you know, just an absolute horse of a defenseman. Truly a world-class guy who, I don't think gets enough credit in our league for what he can do and what he brings to our team.
To Parayko, he walks in, shoots, he scores! Parayko, it's 4-1!
I think Colton Parayko is going to be a good guy to play with now. He was always a big defenseman. I really respect his game, so that'll be a lot of fun to be with him.
And now Parayko, wrap around, and he scores! Parayko! Game winner! Goodbye, good night!
You watch him skate, and
play, like, you can't get anything past him. It's so tough on the D side for other teams to try and create anything in the offensive zone when he's out there. It takes up so much space. And then when he gets that puck, he can get chugging down the ice pretty good. And that's so I think it's one of the favorite things the guys will like to see out there is when Perry takes that thing end to end.
Knocked down by Edmondson, and now the Blues off to the races. And Colton Parayko. And Parayko knocks it by Girard, and Leclaire shoots. He scores! Unbelievable! Parayko with a one-handed goal in overtime. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you. Hop in there. Checked by Robert Thomas. What a pass. Here's Parayko. Shoots. He scores! Unbelievable shot by Parayko.